Good morning, everyone. So good to see that you're all with us here on this amazing summer day. Good morning. Good morning and welcome to the Unitarian Universalist Church of Buffalo. My name is Joan Montagnes, and I have the honor and the privilege of serving you, this congregation, as minister. Welcome to our caring and justice-seeking community. Welcome to you as we begin our July exploration of what it means to be people of joy. Welcome to our virtual worship. Oh my goodness, virtual worship. Okay, a couple of Zoom things to begin with. We can't see or hear you. You can't hear or see each other. You can see and hear the Reverend Fran Manley, who is our worship associate this morning. You can hear and see me, and I'm the minister. And you'll also be able to hear and see Donna Robinson, who will be sharing with us some information about our Share the Plate ministry. You can also chat all the way through the service using the chat box. But when you do that, you probably want to switch the toggle so that you're addressing everyone in the congregation, all the attendees, as well as the panelists. Otherwise, you're just talking to Josh Disick, the technician, and the three of us who you can see. So that's lots of fun. Special thanks today go to Josh Disick, John Petroselli, Karen Streich, Bobby Withrow, and all our music staff, including a volunteer staff today who is Paul Zanoli, who and those folks enrich our Sundays and with worship every single week. Some announcements, just so you know. I'll be on vacation from about July 15th to August 15th. Worship services and all our programs will continue with all kinds of special guest stars. It's gonna be great, so y'all come. And a quick reminder, we do have lots of activities going on through the week on the Zoom platforms. So check out the newsletter and the e-blast and learn more about them. And if you want to receive a copy of the e-blast or the newsletter, please just contact Ashley Mountcastle in the church office. That is enough announcing, I think. So let's just take a deep breath in. Let it go. And call ourselves to worship.
And let us call ourselves to be fully present at this time, at this place, with these words, the poem Praise by the poet Rainer Maria Rilke. Oh, tell me, poet, what do you do? I praise. But the deathly and the monstrous, how do you accept them, bear them? I praise. But the nameless, the anonymous, how, poet, can you still invoke it? I praise. Under every costume, every mask of us, what right have you to be true? I praise. Or that the calm and the impetuous should know you as star and storm, because I praise. Come, let us worship.
When we begin something like worship, or maybe when we're having dinner, or setting aside some time as sacred and holy, or just more meaningful to you, sometimes what we do is we light a candle, we light a chalice to mark that moment. And so that's what we do together. And so if you have a candle or a chalice that you like to light, why don't you join me and do that now? And join me in our chalice lighting words. We gather in loving community, inspiring one another to transform ourselves to create a more just and compassionate world. Let's join in singing, Joyful, Joyful. Once upon a time, there was a little girl named Sandy. She had to be very careful when she went out to play. She wasn't allowed to get too close to any of her friends or share a snack or toys. And she always had to wear a mask. All her friends did. And when she went out with her parents to the grocery store, everyone behaved very weird. They hardly looked at each other in the face. On top of that, all day long, Sandy heard sirens of ambulances and police cars and fire trucks screaming down the street of her neighborhood. And at night, there were always these loud, booming, scary firecrackers. All of this made Sandy feel yucky. Well, one night after dinner, Sandy crawled up on Papa's lap and said, "Papa, I feel yucky. I think I lost my happy." "Oh, dear," said her father. "This is serious. Clearly, tomorrow you need to go out on an adventure. You need to go find some joy." Then he tucked her into bed, and Sandy fell asleep, planning where she would go and what she would do the next day to find some joy. Well, the next morning, Sandy got up. She had her bath and brushed her teeth and put on her best adventuring shorts and t-shirt. She put on a mask and headed out into the backyard. There she found a big rock. Thought Sandy, maybe there's some joy hiding under that rock. Sandy used all her strength and she turned the rock over. Underneath, she saw pill bugs scuttle away and brown centipedes ribbon into the grass, and a pink worm who dug deep down into the soil. But she didn't find any joy under the rock. So Sandy put the rock down again and went to her junior encyclopedia. Thought Sandy, maybe there's some joy in this book. She opened the section of the book all about worms. She learned quite a bit. Worms eat dirt, and when it comes out the other end, it isn't called poop. It's called castings. She also found out that there are giant worms, and they're a yard long, and they're white and fuzzy and smell like flowers. Sandy even discovered that every worm is both a boy and a girl at the same time. Imagine that. In the book, Sandy found out all sorts of fascinating things about worms, but she didn't find any joy. By the time Sandy was done with all this backyard and book exploring, it was dinner time. Daddy had made her favorite spaghetti with red sauce and garlic bread. It was so good. She ate her whole plateful and wiped the plate clean with the garlic bread. Yum! At the end of dinner, she could see the bunny at the bottom of her bowl. But even under all that spaghetti, no matter how hard she looked, she didn't find any joy. After dinner, Sandy crawled up on Daddy's lap. Daddy, today I went on an adventure to find joy. I wanted my happy back. I looked under a rock and saw some wild animals. They were little, but they were still wild animals. I looked up everything about worms in my encyclopedia and learned some pretty cool stuff. And then I had a yummy dinner, but I didn't find joy anywhere. Daddy, what if my happy is gone forever? Daddy rubbed his chin and thought for a moment and then said, you know, honey, when you feel yourself filled with wonder, like when you saw those wild animals under the rock, or when your mind is excited by new truths, like everything you learned about worms, and when you experience something with your ears, eyes, nose, mouth, or fingertips, something that's super good, like your yummy dinner, or this, you and me, and the love we have for one another, and the warm feeling it gives you in your heart, all of that, well, that's joy. I think you found your happy today in lots of great ways. Huh, said Sandy. How about that? And then she began to smile. All in all, I've had a great day. I do feel happy. Then Daddy tucked her into bed. And when Sandy fell asleep, even though she could still hear the sirens wailing and the fireworks going off, she didn't feel yucky at all. She was making plans on how to find more joy tomorrow. Amen.
Every week, our congregation takes a good portion of its Sunday morning offering and gives it away to a social justice cause outside our church walls. This month, we're supporting the good work of RAP, Release Aging People in Prison. And we are delighted to welcome Donna Robinson, the Western New York coordinator of RAP, to tell us more about RAP in a brief video and in her own words.
I'm honored to be here today to ask for you to get on board with the Elder Parole Act and fair and timely parole. I am the mother of a daughter serving 15 years for life in Bedford Hills. What happened to Valerie Gator at Bedford Hills was torture. She was sentenced to 50 years to life. That's a death sentence. She served 41 years, the longest serving woman in New York State. She died August 13, 2019, while I was visiting my daughter at Bedford Hills. Miss Val was an icon. She mentored every woman that came through those gates from 1979 until 2019. But no, she was not eligible for parole until she had served 50 years. I'm 64 years old. To me, that is crazy on so many levels. Val didn't have a fair chance. But I'm begging you with everything in me, no more Valerie Gators. Push, fight, if you stand up. Let them know what we look like. Let them know what it's doing to our families. These people are kings. They are kings. They are queens. And they are worthy of redemption.
Thank you, everyone, for allowing me to fellowship with you this morning, as I have on several occasions. It's always hard for me to watch that video. And it's not just about my daughter who's incarcerated in a women's maximum facility in New York State. It's about everyone who's incarcerated in our 52 prisons. We at RAP, we are dedicated to fight for the ones who are left behind, the ones who are serving life sentences. They have gone to prison to serve a sentence with life on the end, and we don't want that sentence to be a death sentence. So at the end of the credits, if you want to get involved, log in, rapcampaign.com, parole prep, and make a change. Thank you so much for sharing the plate donations this month. The offerings will be used to maintain several individuals who are incarcerated that the world's forgotten about and they have no one to care for. God bless each and every one of you. Stay safe and be well. And again, thank you for allowing me to fellowship with you.
Thank you for being with us today, Donna. There are a couple of ways you can make your offering to the church. You can make your offering by PayPal by going to our website at buffalouu.org and clicking on the blue donate button. Or if you'd rather, you can send a check by mail to the Unitarian Universalist Church of Buffalo, 695 Elmwood Avenue, Buffalo 14222. If yours is a gift to our Share the Plate ministry, please write SHARE on the memo line, and it will be shared between RAP and our church operating budget. If yours is a welcome gift to our congregation, please write Pledge 2020 on the memo line. Either way, please write UUCB on the important line and we'll do the bookkeeping. Let's be generous and bring equity, justice, and joy to all in our community. Our reading this morning is called I Ride Bus. It comes from Rayla D. Matson, who's the Director of Religious Education for the Unitarian Society of Hartford, Connecticut. She writes, "My three-year-old is almost completely nonverbal. Every day when she gets off the bus, I ask her the same question. I ask her how her day was. And every day I get the same answer. Mama, I ride bus. I ask her what she had for lunch and who she played with. I ask her if she went outside or made a new friend. No matter what I ask her, her answer is always the same. Mama, I ride bus." I'll admit, when she was first diagnosed with autism, I cried a lot. And when she worked for months with Birth to Three, a program for infants and toddlers with disabilities, with not much improvement, I cried some more. When school started, and I realized just how far behind the other kids she really was, there were more tears. I don't know whether I cried for her or if I cried for myself. I get angry when people mistreat my daughter or ask me what's wrong with her. I get mad when people avoid her and parents pull their kids away. I struggle when I don't know how her day was or if she has made new friends or if anyone plays with her at all. But all I really want is for my kids to be happy and healthy. Her health is great. And each day, when she gets off the bus, she says with as much joy as she did on that very first day, and with as much enthusiasm as she can muster, "Mama, I ride bus." And for me, shouldn't her joy be enough? Oh, great spirit of the earth, may we find as much joy in the simple pleasures of life as if we were a small child, experiencing some great joy for the very first time.
Let's join our hearts and minds in a quiet moment of prayer, reflection, and meditation. Let's breathe into that uncomplicated place where our souls are comforted. Let us on this holiday weekend dwell not only on independence, perhaps not on independence at all. Let us dwell upon all our connections, our relationships, and our interdependence. Let us reach beyond borders and walls to feel the network of mutuality, that network of mutuality in which we move and live and breathe, knowing we are all embraced by the same immeasurable love. You are held by a love that will not, cannot let you all go just because of who you are right now in the great family of all things. And now let us open our worship to the names of all our loved ones, suffering in sorrow and celebrating in joy, each name a breath, each breath a prayer.
Haughty host in dread silence reposes. What is that which the breeze of the towering steep as it fitfully blows, half conceals, half discloses? Now it catches the gleam of the morning's first beam in full glory reflected, now shines on the stream. Tis the star-spangled banner, oh, long way away, for the land of the free and the home of the brave. And where is that banner? So wantonly swore that the havoc of war and the Basque's confusion, a hunter and a country should leave us no more. Their blood has washed out their foul footsteps, pollution. No refuge could save the hireling and slave from the terror of flight and the gloom of the grave. And the star-spangled banner in triumph doth wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave. Oh, thus be it ever when free men shall stand between their loved homes and the war's desolation. Blessed with victory and peace, may the heaven-rescued land raise the power that has made and preserved us as a nation. Then conquer we must, cause the cause is just. Then conquer we must, cause the cause is just. And this be our motto, in God is our trust. Trust. And the star-spangled banner in triumph shall wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave. And the star-spangled banner in triumph shall wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave.
We hold these precious ones and all their joys and sorrows. We hold the pain of our nation with all its dreams and failings. May the transformative power of our love bring about the healing and the redemption we seek. So be it. Blessed be. And let the church say, Amen. Once upon a time, some people had some issues with the way they were being governed. In effect, they said, no way, we're mad as hell, and we're not going to take it anymore. So they wrote a Declaration of Independence from their overlords. It was a simple document, just shy of 1,500 words. And within the document was the well-known phrase, now well-known phrase, that says, we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equally, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these our life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Oh my, what lofty goals. And my, how they have yet to be realized. During the throes of the Great Depression, the one that happened in the 1930s, not the one that's going on now, during the throes of the Great Depression, Langston Hughes lamented, let America be America again. Let it be the dream it used to be. Let it be the pioneer on the plains seeking a home where he himself is free. America never was America to me. Let America be the dream the dreamers dreamed. Let it be that great strong land of love where never kings connive nor tyrants scheme that any man be crushed by one above. It never was America to me. Oh, let my land be a land where liberty is crowned with no false patriotic wreath, but opportunity is real and life is free. Equality is in the air we breathe. There's never been equality for me, nor freedom in this homeland of the free. Say, who are you that mumbles in the dark? And who are you that draws your veil across the stars? I am the poor white, fooled and pushed apart. I am the Negro bearing slavery's scars. I am the red man driven from the land. I am the immigrant clutching the hope I seek and finding only the same old stupid plan of dog eat dog, of mighty crush the weak. I am the young man full of strength and hope, tangled in the ancient endless chain of profit, power, gain, of grab the land, of grab the gold, of grab the ways of satisfying need, of work the men, of take the pay, of owning everything for one's own greed. I'm the farmer, bondsman to the soil. I'm the worker sold to the machine. I'm the Negro servant to you all. I'm the people, humble, hungry, mean, hungry, yet today, despite the dream, beaten, yet today, O pioneers. I'm the man who never got ahead, the poorest worker bartered through the years. Yet, I'm the one who dreamt our basic dream in the old world while still a serf of kings, who dreamt a dream so strong, so brave, so true that even yet its mighty daring sings in every brick and stone, in every furrow turn that's made America the land it has become. Oh, I'm the man who sailed those early seas in search of what I meant to be my home. For I'm the one who left dark Ireland's shore and Poland's pain and England's grassy lee, and torn from Black Africa's strand, I came to build a homeland of the free. The free? Who said the free? Not me. Surely not me. The millions on relief today, the millions shot down when we strike, the millions who have nothing for our pay, for all the dreams we've dreamed and all the songs we've sung and all the hopes we've held and all the flags we've hung. The millions who have nothing for our pay except the dream that's almost dead today. So wrote Langston Hughes in 1935. I'm reminded of all those other patriotic latter-day prophets, Angela Davis, the Black Panthers, Jimi Hendrix, Colin Kaepernick, all the leaders of the Black Lives Matter movement, and then here with us today, Donna Robinson. I'm reminded of all those patriotic latter-day prophets who said and continue to say in all their anger and grief at the unequal, unfulfilled dream, we're mad as hell and we're not going to take it anymore. Now, books have been written on that enormously problematic set of words that all men are created equal. So let's not dwell there today. We understand just how exclusive that assumption is about gender and who even counts as a man. So let's put that one aside for continuing study. We'll continue to work on that as we go, but not for today. Instead, let's have a little look at what the authors of the Declaration of Independence meant by the pursuit of happiness. While we are trying to explore what it means for us to be people of joy, let's look at this idea of the pursuit of happiness. Now, like most things, it's a little more complicated than it first appears. To begin with, back when the authors were writing, some, 240 odd years ago, the word pursuit did not mean what it means today. It did not mean to seek, to chase after, or to hunt. Pursuit meant to obtain, to have caught, to enjoy in all its fullness right here, right now. Moreover, happiness had a different definition too. Enjoying each simple pleasure of life as if we were small children, experiencing that joy for the very first time, well, that's wonderful. Because such pleasures, such simple pleasures, feed the body and the mind and the spirit on a daily basis, even an hourly basis. No doubt about it. However, these simple pleasures and yummy experiences are not quite the kind of happiness the authors of the Declaration had in mind. The kind of happiness the Declaration speaks of is not simple, light, hedonistic, and momentary pleasure. It is about human fullness and flourishing. It is about the good life and all the good life contains. The authors intended for us to come to terms with the profound truth that a happy life is not only full of real joy, but also real problems and real pain. Those two are part of a life well lived and can even on occasion contribute to human growth and flourishing. I mean, life's gonna throw us those slings and arrows. It can be tough out there. You might be having a very hard time right now, and joy might be pretty hard to find. I get that. The poet Rilke offers sage advice. How do you accept the deathly and the monstrous? How do we bear them? How do we invoke that which gives wonder, lifts our minds, thrills our senses, and fills our hearts with love, that which is nameless, anonymous, holy? How do we remain true to ourselves, even under costume, behind masks? How do we flourish when life keeps cutting us off at the knees? Rilke tells us to praise, to joyfully lift ourselves entirely and open our hearts to the world in spite of and because of it all. Breathe and praise. One final thing the authors of the Declaration intended. They said that experiencing happiness in all its depth and fullness was not thought to be a wistful goal, something you may be lucky enough to obtain if you happen to be in the right place at the right time, know the right people, and pull yourself up by your bootstraps. If you have privilege. No, the author said that happiness is an inalienable right. An inalienable right, happiness. An existential state so like liberty and life that all three are spoken in the same breath. One is either alive or dead, free or enslaved, flourishing or withering. And it's every person's right to be able to choose to live, choose to be free, and choose to flourish. And on top of all of that, we all know we can only choose to live, be free, and flourish if we are in good relationship with the great family of all things, right? My hope for you, as we explore what it means to be people of joy this month and celebrate this holiday weekend, my hope for you is to discover joy like a child every time, the first time, because that kind of joy feeds your body, mind, and spirit. But also discover a flourishing happiness. A flourishing happiness in the freedom and the responsibilities we find in the inescapable network of mutuality. Find happiness in caring for our larger community. Langston Hughes concludes his poem. Oh, let America be America again, the land that never has been yet, and yet must be. The land where every man is free, the land that's mine, the poor man's, the Indians, the Negroes, me, who made America, whose sweat and blood, whose faith and pain, whose hand at the foundry, whose plow in the rain must bring back our mighty dream again. Sure, call me any ugly name you choose, the steel of freedom does not stain. From those who live like leeches on the people's lives, we must take back our land again, America. Oh yes, I say it plain, America never was America to me. And yet I swear this oath, America will be. Out of the rack and ruin of our gangster death, the rape and rot of graft and stealth and lies. We, the people, must redeem the land, the mines, the plants, the rivers, the mountains, and the endless plain. All the stretch of these great green states, and make America again. Please join me in singing, I've Got Peace Like a River.
As we bring our service to a close today, please say with me the words for extinguishing the flame of our chalice. As we extinguish the flame of this chalice, may we carry its light with us into the world in the power of peace, faith, justice, and love.
Let's blow out our chalice. The world sets before you life and death, blessings and curses. The choice is yours to flourish or wither. Therefore, choose joy that both you and all your relations may live and live abundantly. Remember, you are blessed. Remember, you are a blessing. And above all else, remember, you are not alone. You are never alone. So be it, blessed be, and let the church say, Amen.
Thank you.